The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2343 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2343 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And I call Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that people are shutting down their electric and rationing their energy use in the face of rising charges.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Everyone needs a safe, warm place to call home, but we know energy price rises are causing concern, especially for households who are in or at risk of fuel poverty. Regulation of the energy market is reserved, and therefore we need action from the UK Government. The Scottish Government is doing what it can by making £10 million available to help people struggling with their heating costs. This is in addition to the £25 million we are providing to local authorities to tackle financial insecurity and a further £6 million we are providing to third sector partners.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. A report by the Wise Group found that people who live in homes with electric heating are most likely to ration, use or self-disconnect. And the group said that the energy crisis has left people unable to boil a kettle or cook their dinner. And for those who said that they ration or disconnect their electricity heating, 75% do so at least every week. And that's just Greater Glasgow alone. Customers have been told of spending the day sleeping in a bag just to stay warm. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will agree with me. This is an absolute scandal and a worry for ordinary people as the forecast for prices begin to rise. I want to ask the Government why they abandoned their plans to create a publicly owned company and downgrade it to an agency to advise on energy efficiency. I want to ask the Cabinet Secretary if we're going to have a fuller discussion about this proposal, and if not, how does the Government propose to make accessible energy with the powers that they have to ensure that cheaper community-owned heating, for example, is more widely available to people who need it?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I'm aware of the report from the Wise Group that does highlight a number of very serious concerns about those who are being forced into fuel poverty as a result of the escalating costs of energy prices. However, the energy market is regulated by the UK Government and is out with the competence of the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. So what are we doing to try and help to address this? So we're providing this additional £10 million to specifically target those who are at risk of self-disconnection as a result of the costs that they are incurring due to the increase in escalating fuel prices. And we're doing that through the Fuel Bank Network, which is a specific fund and a specific organisation that work with individuals and families who are experiencing these financial difficulties. In relation to the public energy company, as we set out in our manifesto this year and also in our programme for government, the scale and nature of the ground in which we are now dealing with this issue has significantly changed. We now have our net zero commitments that require us to decarbonise over 1 million domestic homes between now and 2030 and 50,000 non-domestic premises. And we need to take concerted action in order to achieve that in a way which is consistent with delivering a just and fair transition without causing individuals to be forced into fuel poverty. And that's why the committee today, I set out to the Net Zero Committee, the way in which we're now undertaking that consultation in the agency, which will be responsible for coordinating that approach to achieving our net zero objectives. But the energy markets need to change. The existing system is unsustainable. I've raised that with the UK Government, and what we now need is we need concerted action on their part in order to address what is a growing crisis right across, not just Scotland, but across large parts of the UK.
Pauline McNeill.
Presiding Officer, let me be quite clear with the Cabinet Secretary. I endorse entirely what you said about the energy market needs to change. We're absolutely at one on that. I just wonder if you would be clear to Parliament, have you closed the door completely on a publicly owned energy company with all the challenges that presents? I would like a yes or no answer to that. But as the Cabinet Secretary says, many of the poorest in our communities have involuntarily become the greenest because they are forced to cut their energy, as you previously heard. Many excluded from net zero initiatives. Two-thirds of respondents in the report felt unable to consider buying an electric vehicle or installing more efficient energy heating. So I ask the Cabinet Secretary, how will the Government go about specifically helping low-income families to share in the benefits of a move to a net zero economy? Scotland has a successful record on renewables, which I applaud. How can ordinary people with low income share in that success?
Cabinet Secretary.
General Officer, on a specific point about the public energy company, as I've set out in Parliament previously, committee, is that what we are looking at is how the Public Energy Agency can help to support the development of what is heat as a service. Which is one of the reasons why we signed a memorandum of understanding with the Danish government, because of their experience in taking forward district heating programmes and the use of heat as a service, which allows local energy providers within communities to develop and actually provide energy to a specific local community. And that's one of the elements of the remit within the Public Energy Agency. So in the prospect of developing some form of local public energy company, there is scope to look at that through the agency's role in considering these issues. On the specifics around the shift towards decarbonisation, moving more towards electric-based energy, one of the issues that needs to change is the existing obligation system within the energy market, which places a greater level of obligations on the electricity side of the market, which as a result forces up the price of electricity, which is one of the areas that we've called upon the UK government to review and consider how that can be changed, because it's causing electricity prices to be artificially higher than they need to be as a result of those obligations. And on a specific point around low-income families, within our heat and building strategy, we set a range of measures that we're going to take forward, including how we make sure that the transition to zero-emission technologies for heating is one which is just and fair, and that we don't find individuals being forced into fuel poverty as a result of having to change their electricity or their heating system. And that's exactly what the heat and building strategy aims to achieve.
Thank you. Before I move on to the next question, can I please ask for more succinct questions and responses? And I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, President Officer. It's a supplemental to that topical question. Minister, what assessment has been carried out regarding the set-up costs of the National Public Energy Agency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, that piece of work is ongoing at the present moment, which is why we launched the consultation today. And as I said, that will be up and running in its full sense by 2025, and it will be in its virtual form over the course of the next year in order to start what is an important area of work. But that will be set out in detail as we move forward with the programme.
Thank you. Marie McNair.
Thank you, President Officer. Households are facing a perfect storm this winter with rising energy bills and the £20 cut to universal credit. What support has the Scottish Government provided to families struggling financially during the pandemic? What further support will be provided this winter? And what impact will the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment have on low-income families?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we're providing a range of support to low-income families during the course of the pandemic, which includes the £130 low-income pandemic payment, which reaches around 500,000 households by the end of October this year. And we're also putting £130 million in the pockets of families through the Scottish Child Payment and the bridging payments. We've also recently announced further support through the £41 million Winter Support Fund, tackling financial and fuel insecurity this winter. And we this week announced that we will double the Scottish Child Payment to support over 106,000 children from April 2022, and will in time help to lift a further 20,000 children out of poverty.
Thank you. Question number two, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported number of deaths of homeless people in 2020.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
While it's hard to measure homeless deaths precisely, experimental statistics published today by the National Records of Scotland are extremely concerning. Every one of these deaths is a tragedy, and I want to offer my sincerest condolences to anyone who has lost a loved one. It's unacceptable that lives are cut short in this way when, in many cases, homelessness can be prevented. Scotland already has some of the strongest protections in the world for people facing homelessness, and we need to go further. We're investing more than £50 million over this parliamentary term to end homelessness and rough sleeping, including support for rapid rehousing and Housing First. And we've committed to introducing new homelessness prevention legislation, and we're improving cooperation between health and housing services with specific measures to help those with more complex needs. And finally, combined with our determination to tackle drug-related deaths, backed by funding of £250 million over the next 5 years, we are determined to support and meet the needs of people facing homelessness.
Willie Rennie.
To be frank, Minister, 256 deaths on this government watch is a national shame. Every single death is a tragedy, and this is a shocking increase. Scotland already had the highest homeless death rate in the whole of the UK, by far. So what is this government getting so badly wrong?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my initial answer to Willie Rennie, I agree every death is a tragedy, and that's why we are taking the steps both on tackling homelessness and tackling drug-related deaths. As I said at the end of my initial answer, determination to tackle drug-related deaths is backed, of course, by £250 million of funding over the next 5 years. And Angela Constance is going to be making a statement later on in terms of further information on residential rehab provision. And on homelessness, we have taken considerable action to tackle homelessness, backed by substantial resources, including the support for rapid rehousing and Housing First, which I think has been recognised as absolutely critical in getting people off the streets, getting them into settled accommodation and wrapping around the support that they need, because we know that giving people a key to a home is not enough when people have addiction issues or mental health issues. And that's why we are pleased to see that around 85% of tenancies through Housing First are being sustained. And that is an important way of supporting people to deal with a range of issues that they face.
Willie Rennie.
I give the Minister another chance, but she still doesn't seem to have a clue what this government is getting so wrong. The Scottish Government were astonishingly complacent after they gave homeless people through the pandemic. They thought that 250 deaths show it's more than a roof it takes to tackle homelessness. Aren't these 256 personal tragedies a reflection of years and years of failed government policies on drugs, on mental health and on homelessness?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't agree with that. What I think we have here is a complex situation with people with a lot of complex needs, and therefore we have to address all of those. And the answers to that are things like the rapid rehousing plans, like Housing First, which is proving itself to be a successful way of supporting people into accommodation, but importantly, wrapping the services around the person. And of course, through the pandemic, working with third sector agencies, we have almost eliminated rough sleeping on our streets, and that is important as well. And I don't know why Willie Rennie is shaking his head at that. I think it's important that our third sector agencies are commended for the work that they've done on eradicating rough sleeping on our streets and supporting that work. On mental health, and Willie Rennie raises an important issue here, because poor mental health can be both a cause and a consequence of homelessness, and that's why we're working with NHS boards and others to address this. Our mental health transition and recovery plan sets out that we're taking in response to the pandemic, supported again by resources, £120 million in funding, and that includes cross-government investment to support the integration of mental health and substance use treatment services. So there's not one single solution here to this really complex issue. We have to do all of these things and more, and that's why the prevention duty is also important as we try to take these issues forward.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One reason charities working with homeless people think these statistics have yet again increased is the fact that people are spending longer in the homelessness system. In 2020-21, annual homeless stats showed that it was taking 248 days for homeless households to actually have their case closed. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary again, what actions will ministers take to actually put in place preventative measures to stop that happening? And will the Scottish Government today agree to Scottish Conservative calls for a full review of access to healthcare services for homeless people and those who are rough sleeping?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Miles Briggs will be aware, as we've had this exchange on a number of occasions in this chamber, that some of the issues relating to moving people through temporary accommodation have been related to COVID, because it slowed down the process of local authorities being able to free up accommodation and move people through temporary accommodation into permanent accommodation. So local authorities, with the support of government, are working through those issues. We're also working with local government to scale up Housing First so that people with the most complex needs can access settled mainstream accommodation with that wraparound support that I spoke about earlier, and that can reduce the time people with most complex needs spend in temporary accommodation. We're also, of course, have seen a move away from the use of night shelters and hostels into that more supported Housing First accommodation. All of these things are important, and I'm sure Miles Briggs, as well as I, would support the efforts of the third sector in working to support our most vulnerable people.
Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would agree, of course, every death of a person experiencing homelessness is a tragedy, and my thoughts are very much with those who have lost loved ones. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what measures the Scottish Government is taking to tackle rough sleeping this winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would hope that no one is going to be rough sleeping this winter, and that's why we have services in place to support people all over the year, and with additional services for people at risk of rough sleeping over the winter period. In line with our commitment to end night shelter accommodation over last winter and this winter, we've provided over £433,000 towards the operation of rapid rehousing welcome centres in Glasgow and Edinburgh, which will provide safe emergency accommodation to those who need it. We've also made flexible emergency funding available to frontline homelessness organisations across the country through our Winter Support Fund, and this will empower frontline homelessness workers to make immediate decisions centred around the specific needs of each individual and assist people to access support in a dignified way.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.